Greetings from St. Andrew the Apostle Catholic Church. Wherever you are, we are happy to have you join us. Today we celebrate the fifth Sunday of Easter. Mass today is offered for the people of the parish. We invite you to participate however you are able. Worship aid is available on the parish website, standrew.org, or in the recent parish email communication. Thank you again for joining us.
Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace from God our Father and the risen Lord Jesus be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Today's gospel, we have the wonderful story of Jesus going to prepare many places for us. The bride inviting the bridegroom home. We'll talk a little bit about that in the homily today. Let us pause for a moment and prepare ourselves to be received into the chambers of the bridegroom.
You will come back again and take us to yourself. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You are the way and the truth and the life. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are in the Father, and the Father is in you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, accomplish the Paschal mystery within us, that all you are pleased to make new in baptism may come to the joy of an eternal Easter. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. As the number of disciples continued to grow, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. So the 12 called together the community of disciples and said, "It is not right for us to neglect the word of God to serve at table. Brothers, select from among you 7 reputable men filled with the Spirit and wisdom, whom we shall appoint to this task, whereas we shall devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The proposal was acceptable to the whole community, so they chose Stephen, a man filled with faith and the Holy Spirit. Also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas of Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid hands on them. The word of God continued to spread, and the number of the disciples in Jerusalem increased greatly. Even a large group of priests were becoming obedient to the faith. The word of the Lord.
And all your
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, come to him, a living stone, rejected by human beings, but chosen and precious in the sight of God. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it says in Scripture, behold, I am laying a stone in Zion, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in it shall not be put to shame. Therefore, its value is for you who have faith. But for those without faith, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, a stone that will make people stumble, and a rock that will make them fall. They stumble by disobeying the word, as is their destiny. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of his own, so that you may announce the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way. Thomas said to him, Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, then you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Master, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you for so long a time, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. The Father who dwells in me is doing his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe because of the works themselves. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I do and will do greater ones than these because I am going to my Father. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Your risus paschalis, or Easter joke, comes with a thought of tomorrow's American feast of Mother's Day. So I thought we should have a piece from that supermom of the news syndicate, Irma Bombeck. And she writes, "A lot of things have been done in bed in the name of love, but nothing comes close to the traditional Mother's Day breakfast in bed. On this day, all over the country, mothers are pushed back into their pillows. Their bird of paradise, which blooms every other year for 15 minutes, is snipped and put in a shot glass, and a strange assortment of food comes out of a kitchen, destined to take the sight out of a good eye. A mixer whirls out of control, then stops abruptly, and a voice cries, 'I'm telling.' A dog barks, and another voice says, 'Get his paws out of there, Mom has to eat that.' Minutes pass, and finally, 'Dad, where's the chili sauce?' Then, 'Don't you dare bleed on Mom's breakfast.' The rest is a blur of banging doors, running water, rapid footsteps, and finally, 'You started the fire, you put it out.' The breakfast itself is fairly standard: a water tumbler of juice, 5 pieces of coal black bacon that snap in half when you breathe on them, a mound of eggs that would feed a Marine division, and 4 pieces of ice cold toast. They line up on your bed to watch you eat, and from time to time ask why you're not drinking your Kool-Aid or touching the cantaloupe with the black olives on top spelling out M-O-M. Later that night, after you've decided it's easier to move to a brand new house than clean the kitchen, you return to your bed where you encounter beneath the blanket either A, a black jelly bean, B, a planter's wart, or C, the black olive that put the O in M-O-M. And if you're wise, you'll reflect on this day, because for the first time your children gave instead of received. They offered up to you their sincerest form of flattery, trying to emulate what you would do for them. They gave you one of the greatest gifts people can give: themselves. So happy Mother's Day to all of you who know that privilege. We'll have a special blessing for you at the end of the Mass. And I hope your Mother's Day breakfast in bed goes well and you don't have to move. First, a little bit of background on the imagery that Jesus uses in this gospel. The setting for the text is the Last Supper. This gospel is part of what's called the farewell discourse in John's gospel, which stretches from the beginning of chapter 13 all the way to the end of chapter 17. It includes the washing of the disciples' feet. And we see in this passage the tender love that Christ has for us. It's the night of his betrayal, the night before he is going to be crucified, and what's his concern? It's to comfort and reassure his disciples. "Do not let your hearts be troubled," he tells them. The next part is translated, "Have faith in God and faith in me," but it's kind of weak. It would be better if it said, "Trust in God, trust also in me," because the Greek word used here carries connotations more of engagement and relationship rather than being abstract and detached like "have faith." Thomas and Philip openly express their unease with Jesus' declarations that they know the way he's going. Thomas candidly blurts out, "We don't know. Though the others may act like they know the path you're on, I don't know, and I'll admit it." Thomas probably sensed that things were not going to end well. He and Philip express confusion and ignorance about where Jesus is going and what the Father looks like. And Jesus reassures them and us that he is going away in order to prepare a place for us. Now, the folks who would have first read this or heard it would have understood the background to it. In ancient Middle Eastern culture, extended families often lived together in the same house. So when a young couple became engaged to be married, the bridegroom would go back to his father's house and add on some additional rooms for he and his new bride. Once the building project was complete, he would then be able to come and claim his bride
and take her back to the newly expanded house. The wedding would only take place after the bridegroom had gone away and completed the project and prepared a new home for his bride. So when Jesus says that he is going to his Father's house to prepare a place for him, for us, he's talking like a bridegroom to his beloved. And this bridegroom deeply loves his bride because he's preparing many rooms in his Father's house. He's making a promise to return for us and to bring us to a new home, eternal life with God. And only Jesus can make this promise because he is, as he told his disciples, the path to God, the way, the truth, and the life. We also need to remember that in Scripture, Christ is always the bridegroom, and we are his beloved spouse as the church. Second, I think this is really a wonderfully comforting image in a time of our COVID-weary lives. Right now, a lot of people are feeling displaced or out of place, or perhaps our place is fractured by job loss, isolation, seemingly endless bad news. And when we, as human beings, lose a sense of place, we usually don't do very well. Think about every time you've had to move in life. It's always very difficult to move. We lose home. We feel confused. Everything that was familiar is gone. Everything new is strange. It's foreign. It's different. We don't know how to get around. We don't know where things are. None of us ever imagined that modern American life could be anything like it is at the present. And so there is a lot of tension. I'm hearing getting a lot of phone calls and emails now from families who are struggling. Families are struggling because they're together 24 hours a day. Single people are struggling because they're alone 24 hours a day. It'd be nice if we could all switch it up, but it's not that way. It's become a big whoop just to go to the grocery store, but we don't even feel comfortable doing that with our masks and sanitizers and wipes. And where in the world is the toilet paper? And so my third point. Even in this currently rather weary world, yet again, comes the God who comes, Emmanuel, our God with us. And once again, in a time of crisis, like that Last Supper setting, he comes with words of assurance and hope and tenderness. I've not forgotten you. Any more than I had forgotten or was neglecting my disciples the night before I was put to death on the cross. No, I am right here. I am with you. I am beside you. I am going before you to prepare a place for you. Because in my Father's house, I'm preparing many dwelling places. We have one who creates home for us, who is home for us. Frederick Buechner wrote a beautiful little book called Longing for Home, and in it he has these words: "No matter how much the world shatters us to pieces, we carry within us a vision of the wholeness that we sense is our true home and that forever beckons to us." That's what this gospel gives us, the vision of our true home. The gospel is perfect for us today. Jesus learned as he grew and matured that his home was not Nazareth, where he had grown up. It was not even with his 12 hand-picked friends, even though they had left their own homes and slept under the stars with him. He always reminded them, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." They were feeling disoriented, dislocated, unsure, and Jesus reassured them, and he reassures us. There's a bigger vision, God's vision, and he is always working to fulfill it. The heaven, the new and eternal Jerusalem. Trust me, Jesus is saying to us. I will take you to myself so that where I am, you also may be. I know many of us are longing for home as we used to know it, church as we used to know it, shopping, interacting, traveling, dining out as we used to know it. But when we reflect a bit on our Catholic tradition, we realize that out of place is a rather natural state for us to be as disciples of Jesus Christ. This pandemic has forced all of us to look at our lives once again. There are obviously some who are refusing to do so. But if we are reflecting and praying at all, we can see that this pandemic might not be such a terrible thing to be experiencing after all. We've often thought of American culture as a bit wacky, kind of shallow, and overly attached to stuff and money. It's the words of Jesus, "Be not anxious about how you are to dress or what you are to eat. Behold the lilies of the field and the birds of the sky. Your heavenly Father always cares for them." When we lose our job or our health or all of a sudden things look very differently, then suddenly stuff is not very important. Jesus spent much of his ministry telling us not to allow ourselves to become too settled. Unless you're willing to leave mother and father, jobs and place, unless you're able to put your hand to the plow and not look back, you cannot be my disciple. What Jesus means is that we cannot find our place in the future with him, the only place that is lasting and worth settling down in, unless we let go of the death grip that other places and things have upon us in this world. Sometimes it takes a pandemic to get this through our fat heads. All of life is a journey. This is the very nature of life itself. We can deny it, we can fight it, but sooner or later we're going to have to surrender to it and accept that we are into a new reality. The tidal wave of change is the nature of life. And if we get on that surfboard and ride it out, we can know that there's a certain thrill to the whole process after all. The Catholic tradition has taught us this from the very beginning. This is from the early second century epistle of Methodius to Diognetus. He writes, "As citizens, Christians share all things with others, and yet endure all things as foreigners. Every foreign land to them is as their native country, and every land of their birth as a land of strangers. They pass their days on earth, but they're citizens of heaven." I think this is a wonderful quote to keep in mind as we move through this very jarring time. Ultimately, our deep need for settledness, for safety, for security and assurance will only be met in heaven. Heaven is our place. God is our place in all the ups and downs of life. Yes, we have our little places that make us feel at home and okay. These are good things, but they're limited. A pandemic reminds us just how limited they truly are and forces us to reevaluate that we are often very much overattached to them. We are a place for families and all we love. We are a place for those who depend upon us for nurture and shelter. We are a place for our friends and coworkers. We are a place for one another throughout life, until we find our true and eternal place. This pandemic is another reminder that we need to focus on eternal realities and to let some of our attachments go. Interestingly, one of the powerful names of God in the Jewish rabbinic tradition is the place. God is our place. God is our destination. Our place, in the end, is really not a place at all, but a relationship. We're not talking about a house of the Lord so much as a home with the Lord. and there alone will we be at rest. Until then, we can pray with St. Augustine, our hearts are made for you, O God, and so they are restless, and they will not rest until they find their rest in you. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all worlds, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Now let us offer our petitions.
For the church, that we may fulfill our call to be living stones who make Christ's presence known, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are in need, that they may be filled with nourishment of body, soul, and spirit, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For deacons, that they may be strengthened in their vocation of service by God's love and the support of the community, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For medical researchers, that they may be inspired and strengthened by a love for every human person as they search for a cure to the coronavirus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, including Michael Flatley, Sandy Hughes, Bob Camia, Dan Camia, Daniel Venezia, Dave Twelman, Terry Weber, Gerard Nocera, and the Cates family, and all who are affected by the coronavirus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers in our Book of Intentions, for those who have asked for our prayers, and for the prayers of all here, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the people of the parish for whom this Mass is offered, and for all who have died, including Timothy Rumsey, Robert Kuhn, and Larry Bearfield, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, you have given us infinitely more than we could ask for or even imagine. Hear our prayers through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. pray, sisters and brothers, that this, our sacrifice, may become acceptable to God, our loving Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all his holy church.
O God, who by the wonderful exchange effected in this sacrifice, have made us partakers of your Godhead, grant that we may come to know your truth and make it ours by a worthy way of life. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed. Integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as we acclaim.
Therefore, these gifts we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember your church, spread throughout the world, and bring us to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Luis Rafael, our Bishop, all clergy, religious, and all who seek you with sincere hearts. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Joseph, her spouse, the apostles, Andrew, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin. Protect us from all anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your friends, I leave you peace. Peace is my gift to you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Grant to us the peace, the unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. How blessed are those called to share at the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Please join us in the prayer of spiritual communion. Lord,
as I cannot enjoy the joy of participating in Mass physically today, I unite with the Church Universal in prayer, offering my heart to be given over to you in greater faith, hope, and love. May this moment with you help me to be a more faithful, generous, and loving member of the body of Christ, the Church. Amen.
Let us pray. Be present to us, O Lord, and lead all you have imbued with these heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. This time we would like to invite the mothers and the parish, or who are listening out there in TV land, if you would kneel for a special blessing. And I'd ask the members of the family who are nearby to extend your hands in blessing over them. Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over the Church. Bless these women that they may be strengthened in their vocation as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound love and respect. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. The Mass is ended. Go in peace. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.